It's actually got a big needle. 3, 2, 1. Hey everyone, and welcome back on the channel. My name is Alex. I hope you're all doing very well. Today we are looking at the Abbott Libre Sense glucose monitoring sensors. It's my last day with the sensor on my arm. It's right here. And I'm gonna take you through my 2 week experience with the sensors, the positives, the drawbacks, and the main takeaways for myself, my athletic performance and all that stuff. Let's go right now, let's begin with the positives. And first of all, the ease of installation. So I'm gonna take you 2 weeks back from now, back to the day where when I installed the sensor on my arm. So here we go. Let's take a look at that. There you go. So that's the sensor and that's the application device. So I will stick it here like this. Okay, so first of all, I'm supposed to open the sensor box. Open, the needle is actually quite big. Well, I'm supposed to unscrew this. So I need to, now it's, and if I remove it, it's actually got a big needle. It will be here, I guess. That's okay. Yeah, that should be okay. 3, 2, 1. All right. Is that it? Is it in? Hey, I can see it there. Oh, well. I wouldn't say it was pain-free. It was not too painful, but it wasn't pain-free, if that makes sense. But here it is, the biosensor is on my arm. Okay, so as you can see, the installation process is pretty much straightforward. I was personally a bit worried about not so much the needle and the pain, but more, you know, the fact that I could mess up and that the thing would not stick to my arm. It was, it went perfectly fine. So that's a good thing. And I think, you know, pretty much anyone can install it themselves on the arm without any assistance. But of course, if you have someone around, that's always nice to, you know, maybe take a look together, but you can do it on your own and that's a very good thing. Now, the second positive point for me is the SUPERSAPIENS app that you have on your smartphone. It's very straightforward, very easy to use, and most importantly, it has lots of, you know, clear indications of where you should be, why, and how the whole thing works. I wasn't very aware myself about not the numbers, not the trends, the zones in which you're supposed to be. And it's really good to be able to rely on the app, especially for someone who doesn't necessarily have all the knowledge associated with glucose monitoring and glucose in sports performance. So, I mean, the app is really nicely done. It has all those, you know, values that you should hit for a day, the variability, the average glucose levels, the zones for the different activities. So all of that is really well made, and you can clearly figure out if you're doing things right, wrong, or if you can improve in certain areas, which is really nice and pretty straightforward to see with the app. And I think that's a really good thing. Now, if you look at the drawbacks, there are a few of them. No deal breaker, but good to have in mind also before jumping into the experience. The first drawback for me is obviously the price. The sensors are not cheap by any means. One sensor worth 2 weeks of monitoring is 65 euros, so probably around that $65-70 as well. Or you have the subscription model where you pay, I think it's 125 euros for two sensors, so that's 1 month essentially, and you get a new pack with two sensors every month. I think the price, you know, is high, but for myself, I can see you know, ordering it once a year for a month during a training camp or a high intensity period in my training. Other than that, I wouldn't subscribe for the whole year simply because it's, you know, it's too expensive, basically. And
I don't see the use of that type of high level sensors all year round. Another drawback when looking at the sensor is the compatibility with devices that you're using for your training. What I mean by this is that for the moment you can monitor the glucose live on the phone, which is great, via the app. The app is very well designed, as I mentioned in the positives. But when it comes to other devices, like your watch or your bike computer, the compatibility isn't great at the moment. I think this is something SuperSapiens is working on. So eventually we may have more devices that will be available to track your glucose live during training and racing. At the moment, only Garmin devices are supported and only the most recent models. So if you have an old Garmin watch, or like me, a watch that's not Garmin, that's my Coros Pace 2 watch, you cannot link it to your sensor. And even if you have a Garmin watch that is supported, you need to have your phone alongside the watch to have the reading on the watch, because the thing goes via the phone at the moment and not directly sensor to watch, which is a bit a bummer, because obviously if you're racing, you don't carry your phone with yourself. And I think again that's something SuperSapiens will improve, but at the moment it's a drawback. My bike computer is supposedly compatible, but I could not figure out how to make it work, and I think that's the case for pretty much everyone at the moment with Garmin bike computers trying to link it to the SuperSapiens sensor. The firmware was released a few days ago, so you know, these are the type of little glitches that happen when something new like a firmware is released. I was a bit, you know, disappointed not to be able to try it directly on the bike computer. You can see it here. I set up the data screen on my Garmin bike computer, but nevertheless, because the firmware is very recent, I could not try it properly. I guess that when this will be working, it will be a great feature. Even more so when you won't have to carry the phone with you. I have a second sensor and I will be trying the compatibility with the bike computer and hopefully with my Coros watch later on in the summer, but for now, I guess, you know, the compatibility is a drawback. And so last part of the video, I will talk to you about the takeaways for myself. Before that, if you're enjoying this video or find the content of the channel useful or fun, please do not hesitate and subscribe to the channel, like the video. That's a great help for the channel and a big boost of motivation for myself. So the takeaways. The first takeaway, and that's not really a takeaway, but I was happy to see this. My overall average glucose levels are pretty much spot on, meaning that I think my average for the 2 weeks was 92 milligrams per, I think, deciliter. That's the value. And the recommendation is to have something around the 90 mark. Keeping in mind that the range in which you're fine is going from 70 to 140. So I was, you know, with my 92, I was pretty much spot on. I think the highest day I had was something like 100 or 101, and the lowest one was 88, something like that. So that's great. But that's not really a takeaway, because if things are already good, then how can you improve? So let's look at the things that are not necessarily perfect. And for me, that's more the variability. So what is the variability of your glucose? It's essentially the trends and the variations between the highest points and the lowest points. And what you're looking for is something very stable to have the less variation, the less variability as you can. Why? Because variability isn't bad as such, but high changes in your glucose levels mean that either you're having foods with that high glycemic index, so basically those fast sugars that you consume very, very quickly and that do not provide you with long-term energy. And also the high variability is linked to the body working harder, because essentially the glucose levels are going higher and you're producing more insulin, to counterbalance that. So the body's working harder, you may experience fatigue, maybe, you know, lack of energy, lack of focus, and that's because your body is trying to compensate for either the very high glucose that you put into it with those fast sugars, or the very low dips as well. That may be due to not fueling yourself enough or not with the proper sources. So my variability was okay, but it could really be better. I had a variability of around 15 or 17 milligrams per deciliter over the 2 weeks period. That was some kind of the average. The recommendation is more in that 10 to 12 milligrams per deciliter of variability. So I was a bit higher than that. Now there's no big deal either, but I can certainly improve things in that area. How? Basically trying to find sources of food with maybe lower glycemic indexes, although I'm already paying attention to this. So, you know, I don't wanna go either into something too restrictive or too hard to maintain on the long run. But I can, you know, I can try and play a bit around with those things and find sources of food that give me a bit more stable of that glucose levels. So keeping the average, which is already spot on for me, but trying to have less, you know, peaks and lows throughout the day. Now, a few interesting things that I noticed is that my peaks are not necessarily correlated with that fast sugars. I mean, they are, but not the way I would imagine, because I'm not really eating added sugars in my you know, in my food throughout the day. I'm not adding sugars anywhere. So if I'm eating them, it's either because they're naturally in the food or because they're added in some transformed products, although I'm trying to eat as little of those processed food as possible. And most of the time we're actually not eating any because we're not huge fans of those things. So for instance, I can have peaks when drinking a coffee first thing in the morning, which is a bit surprising because you would think, okay, I'm just drinking coffee, adding a bit of oat milk, for instance, in it. And all of a sudden, without, of course, no sugar in the coffee, but black coffee, a bit of oat milk, one mug, you know, in the morning, one cup of coffee in the morning. And all of a sudden, my glucose levels going from past bedtime around that 70, 75 milligrams per deciliter zone are peaking at 130, 140. And that's certainly playing a big role on the variability numbers, and that's just because of a cup of coffee. Same with the way I'm maybe planning my meals throughout the day. So very often, you know, I'm having breakfast, lunch, and then dinner. But on the days where I try to, for instance, separate during the lunch the main dish and, for instance, the dessert, which very often for me is oatmeal. I'm having oatmeal pretty much after each and every meal. So, you know, when I'm trying to separate that and say have the main dish, for instance, pasta, I'm making this up, but for instance, pasta at lunch and not right after my oatmeal dessert or my banana dessert, but let's say have that 2 or 3 hours break between the two, then of course my glucose levels are more stable because I'm not putting into my body, even though there are low glycemic sources, type of glucose, I'm not putting them all of them together, but I'm trying to split these into, you know, lunch and then some sort of snack where, for instance, 3 p.m. I'm gonna have my oatmeal, then dinner around that 6, 7 p.m. time, and maybe, you know, an apple or another oatmeal if I'm still hungry at 9 or 9:30 p.m. in the evening. And that creates a more stable type of glucose levels, and then therefore less of that variability and something better. So that's the few things that I noticed essentially. And the last takeaway for me, and that's really related to sports, is the fact that most of my activities seem to be underfueled. And by that, I mean that the app was showing me that I was below the optimal targets in terms of glucose levels for the activities that I performed. The caveat to that being that most of what I did in the past 2 weeks was very easy, and therefore I wasn't, you know, feeling like crazy in terms of gels, bars, and so on, but more either fasted or with some low intakes. And so, you know, that's the caveat, but still the app was saying that I was a bit below the optimal zones of glucose for the activities that I performed. And I think that's, you know, one of the takeaways that I could work on when I will plug the second sensor in later this summer during my training camps or whatever, and see if I can maintain more higher levels of glucose during my sports activities, and see if that has a real impact on my performance. I know that my body has probably quite adapted to burning fats, and therefore low glucose levels are fine because I'm coping well with that, but I'm eager to see if fueling more and having higher glucose levels can have a good impact on my performance, either in training or in racing. So that's the kind of stuff that we'll find out when I will use the second sensor later on this year. For now, this is it. I hope you enjoyed this video. Maybe you are looking to buy a set of sensors yourself and try it. Let me know in the comments if that's the case. I'm very happy to share my experience further in the comments with you, answer your questions, and obviously, you know, go back and forth with you in that comment section. That's something I really like to do. In the meantime, enjoy your run today, your ride, go beyond your limits, and most importantly, guys, take care. Bye-bye.